Hi, so welcome to Madeleine Powell. Madeleine is a clinical nurse researcher at the Princess Alexandra Hospital ICU, and she has a background in adult intensive care and cardiothoracic surgical nursing. She has collaborated on a diverse range of research methodologies and project areas, including human factors simulation research, improving clinical handover, randomized controlled trials and quasi-experimental trials, mixed methods studies, and quality improvement projects. Madeleine is completing a Master of Public Health and Health Management, where she is furthering the development of her skills in research methodology and translational research. She's an author on published articles and a member of ACCCN. Welcome, Madeleine.
Thanks. So good afternoon, and thanks for letting me share today the results of our observational handover study. So why did we want to observe and investigate handover? So clinical handover is a high-risk event for our patients. That's as ineffective handover can lead to a decrease in continuity of care, increased adverse events, and legal claims of malpractice. Discharging patients from the ICU to the general ward is a high-risk event due to the nature, the complexity, the acuity, and the number of our patients' medical conditions, coupled with the significant reduction in monitoring and nursing care. Suboptimal clinical handover can lead to unnecessary ICU readmissions and also increased patient mortality. And risks are further exacerbated for our multi-trauma patients as they have complex needs. So we wanted to determine our current nursing handover for our trauma patients when they were discharging to the wards. We also wanted to understand our ICU and ward nurses' perceptions of this process. So we used a qualitative study design that, and we gathered information from a whole range of data sources, such as naturalistic observation, chart audits, and semi-structured interviews of both our ICU and our ward nurses. We conducted the study at a tertiary referral hospital that's a level one accredited trauma centre. It admits 2,200 patients yearly, and 300 of which are trauma patients. All planned clinical handovers of trauma patients that were discharged to the ward during the nursing research working hours were included, as long as the patients were over the age of 18 and able to communicate in English. We also recruited their respective ICU and ward nurses. So our research nurse observed handover from a distance taking field notes with the use of a comprehensive data collection tool that was designed by our research team. This assessed handover for structure, organisation, and process. We compared the field notes to a chart audit to assess for accuracy, comprehensiveness, and relevance of the content. Immediately after the handover, our ICU nurses were interviewed. We allowed about an hour between the handover and interviewing our ward nurses so that they had some time to settle the patient in and maybe find any issues or concerns. Interviews were face-to-face and audio-taped. We used semi-structured questions, prompts, and probing questions. Interviews sought feedback on the perceptions of handover, including barriers and facilitators to the process, and also maybe any outcomes of the handover, such as implications of deficits or errors. And we continue to recruit patients until we reach data saturation. So on average, our patients had 2.5 body systems affected from their traumatic event. They stayed in ICU for 6 days and they were in hospital for an average 17 days, suggesting to us that we had some complex and acute patients that we recruited. Our trauma patients were discharged to in total 8 different specialty wards, giving us a diverse range of specialty nurses who participated in our study. When looking at nursing characteristics, our ICU nurses had considerably more years of experience than the ward nurses. This has been suggested it might decrease the ward nurses' level of comfort and likelihood to ask questions of us. So when we had a look at the process, our observation highlighted some challenges. The ward nurses were frequently not ready for the transfer. Sometimes they weren't even aware the transfer from ICU was going to occur, and one ward nurse was on their break. Equipment was frequently not ready for the transfer, and sign-off was poorly documented. And then we also had poor patient and family involvement. In fact, basically no involvement. We highlighted by the fact that we never actually asked the patients or family if they had questions at the end of handover. There was also a lack of consistency in our methods we used, as we had different structures and different methods for handover. So our interviews highlighted some common themes that related to the process as well. Both the ICU and ward nurses found that we had diverse handover methods, with our ward nurses saying that a more standardised process is needed, as it differs from nurse to nurse. And our ICU nurse pointed out that there was different perceptions and expectations of handover, saying, "I kept going back when I was interrupted by the ward nurse. I had to go back because they kept changing the subject." They also revealed that they'd come up with their own strategies to help aid the handover delivery, saying, "It would be good to have a way to go, right, we've covered all of these things. That's why I always print the medical discharge summary, so I can make sure that I've looked at everything." They also suggested checklists would help aid in delivery, in preparation, saying the ward should have a checklist of what information they want to know from us so they can be prepared, like what infusion pumps do they need. They also highlighted that workload and interruptions impact handover, saying, "I think the nurse was distracted with two admissions coming in at once, and also that there was constant interruptions from nursing staff, lots of noises and conversation and stuff behind me." So, when we were having a look at content, there were some components of handover that we handed over well and frequently. However, I would like to point out that even though we did handover injuries correctly 9 out of the 10 times, the instance when we did we missed some injuries, they were clinically significant. There's a minimally displaced sacral fracture and bilateral pneumothoraces for this patient. And also in the instance when we missed the airway and oxygen saturation, this patient had high oxygen requirements, they're on high flow, and they did saturated that day in ICU. Shortly after the transfer to the ward, the patient desaturated again, required urgent medical review and interventions. And so conversely, there were some areas that we could improve on, including handing over the identity of the patient when they got to the ward, and also some clinically relevant information such as blood sugar levels, blood testing results, and temperature. Now, it might be said that nurses are more likely to hand over abnormal data rather than normal data. However, when investigating a little further, for example with temperature, 5 out of the 7 patients who didn't have this information handed over had been febrile that day, and also looking at blood tests and results, one of these patients had pretty low electrolytes that required replacement immediately after the transfer. And so there was also some common themes that related to content. Particularly, our ICU and ward nurses highlighted some areas and some deficits of the handover that could impact patient safety, the most prominent being that of the missed oxygenation saturations, when the nurse expressed concern saying, "His oxygen saturations are very low. I should probably have done them when the ICU nurse is still here. His SATs are 79%. However, they did say that when a structured approach was used, the handover was effective, giving such comments such as, "She did a really good head-to-toe and covered every system." Now, interestingly, we asked the nurses if they thought handover was more difficult for a trauma patient than a non-trauma patient. And actually, they said no. It depends on the acuity of the patient, more so if they are a trauma or non-trauma. If they are more acute, there are more things to go over, and more attachments make it harder. They also expressed that the multidisciplinary nature of patient care increases complexity, saying, "I think it's really difficult to know who's involved. There's so many teams, there's sometimes conflicting information." So, we were able to find some clinically significant deficits in our handover. This adds to the evidence that transitions of care for ICU patients are high-risk events, and that communication breakdowns can result in a loss of information and potentially poor patient outcomes. Examination of the handover process highlighted multiple challenges of between ward collaboration and communication, including that sometimes there was incongruent and different expectations of handover. Also that there was variability and inconsistency in our handover methods, and how that workloads, time pressures, and interruptions impact handover. Now, our ICU and ward nurses both said that the complexity of handover did not differ between trauma and non-trauma patients, but rather increased with patient acuity. So this, to us, says that we should improve handover for all of our ICU patients. And both our ICU and ward nurses advocated for a structured and standardised approach to handover, indicating to us that the implementation of intervention to improve structured handover would be good and would be well received. Now, our study was just limited to trauma patients on one site, so it might not be able to be generalised to other units and other patient cohorts. But we could argue that our ICU discharges and our trauma patients do present some of the most complex and diverse patient scenarios. So we were able to effectively identify our current handover practice and the perceptions of the handover process. This identified deficits in our interdepartment handover, indicating need for improvement. And our findings suggest that handover could be improved by the development and implementation of a specialised ICU handover tool and for all of our ICU patients. Thanks.
Thanks, Madeleine.
Any questions from the floor?
Thanks very much, an excellent presentation. I've done work with the Gold Coast for a number of years, a while ago now though, and I found myself nodding everything you were saying. I thought, yes, yes, yes. One of the things we found, I'm wondering if you noticed it, or two things, we found that sometimes the person who, for example, would give a telephone handover, it went to, say, the person who shouldn't have received it. And the other, I've just forgot the second thing. The ward staff often said that what was handed over, some of the essential things they wanted, wasn't handed over. Things that the ICU nurses hadn't thought about that were important for the ward staff, about had this patient been out of bed or are they going to fall over and that kind of stuff. Did you find any of sort of an incongruence between what the ICU nurses were handing over and what the ward nurses wanted from the handover?
I think so. I think our ICU nurses are very focused on giving a very systematic approach and giving all of the information, whereas the ward nurses want to get to the crucial information that they need to know, and particularly because they have such high workloads. They've got other patients they're trying to think about, so they want to get down to the nitty-gritty and then move on, kind of.
Thanks, Maddie. So this study was in a hospital that uses an electronic patient record. Did you have much feedback from the nurses about the effect that they felt that had on how they handed over?
Yes, that was another one of the themes that we found. More so expressed by the ward nurses, and they highlighted, because we've got two different electronic systems, so when you're there in the ward, they can't access any of the information and OBS or anything that happened while the patients were in ICU. So they express that, say, if their patient deteriorates on the ward, they're unable to go and compare and see what they were like, say, 5 hours ago. And, yeah, if there's been a worsening or, you know. So they definitely highlighted that was a problem. Yeah.
Yes. Sometimes patients are bounced out of ICU in a very urgent situation, like there's a need to admit a very critically ill patient and some patient might be well looked after on the ward. Did you find that in any of your studies that such patients tend to do, their handover is worse off than patients who are discharged to the ward in a planned manner?
In a planned manner?
Yeah.
So all of our handovers that we observed were all planned, because we could only do them within working hours. So any handovers that happened out of hours or anything weren't included. But the literature does show that those kind of handovers out of hours are worse and have increased patient adverse events and things, yeah.
I just got one question about the methods. You said that there was a observer documenting the process. Did the ward nurses, were they aware of that?
Yes.
There was someone there?
They were. The ward nurses, yeah. So we got consent from the ward nurses to participate because then we wanted to interview them. So they were also aware that there was someone observing, and the ICU nurses were aware as well. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody. That concludes this session, but there is another session commencing in half an hour after morning or afternoon tea, I should say, followed by the welcome drinks tonight. I've caught your thing.
Sorry, I was thinking.
No, you haven't.
Something I need, yeah, in this world full of people, there's one killing me, and if we only